Okay, welcome everyone to AXSchat. We're really excited to welcome Ricardo García from Spain, and he's going to talk a lot more about what they're doing in Spain. And I'm very proud to call Ricardo a very close personal friend of mine. We also have Antonio here today. And Neil can't join us because it is his wedding anniversary, so he's taking a holiday to celebrate that anniversary. So we're really excited about talking to Ricardo today. So welcome.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me on today. It's a real honor to be with you guys today, and looking forward to seeing where this takes us to.
Well, I know we've been very eager to talk to you, and Antonio is especially eager to talk because Antonio comes from Portugal, even though he's living in Ireland also. So, Antonio?
Yeah, it's very interesting how we connect now different parts of the world under the conversation of accessibility. So, Ricardo, can you tell us about a little bit about yourself, what you do, and what projects you are in at this moment?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'm based here in Madrid, and I'm working for ILUNION, one of the companies within ILUNION. ILUNION is the business foundation's business group, and that's the result of the merger of the two former business groups that were owned by ONF and the ONF Foundation that were created back many years ago to generate additional funds besides the lottery itself, and mainly to create jobs for persons with disabilities. Right. So I'm working at a company called Disability Studies and Projects that just called Technosite. People may be more familiar with. And I'm in charge of business development here at ILUNION ASP.
Deborah?
Yes, I'm here. I see that we have a little bit of a delay, yes. So we're going to be very cautious to try not to step on each other. But I know, Ricardo, that I had the pleasure to meet you a few years ago because of Technosite. And Technosite is, in my eyes, is one of the world's best organizations, very focused on ICT accessibility. We're doing a lot of work, I know, in Europe and in Latin America and Africa and the Middle East. And it was something that I've had the pleasure to work with Technosite and Via Libra, one of the other companies, quite a bit. So I was very excited to, you know, talk more about that. And of course, employability is very, very important to me. So I would be curious if you could talk a little bit about how your organization has created this umbrella of businesses that support each other, not only to make sure things are fully accessible, but also to make sure that people with disabilities are more meaningfully employed in Spain.
Right, yeah, absolutely. The Foundation's business group was created just after the foundation was created in 1988. Business group was created in 1989 as an instrument to actually fulfill one of the foundation's mission back then. That was a creation of jobs, meaningful jobs for persons with disabilities, as you say, all disabilities, and therefore at the time the ONF Foundation received funds from the ONF to actually invest and actually purchase several companies in different industries, mainly those industries where where jobs, let's say, could be jobs for persons with disabilities could be more easily created. Right? That means the jobs or industries that are highly intensive in the workforce, and therefore several companies, like for example, the industrial laundry chain was created. to become, currently is the leading industrial laundry chain in Spain with the largest market share here in the country, with 4,000 employees, and 90% of them are persons with disabilities. So as you can see, the main focus or the main objective was not only to create jobs per se for persons with disabilities, but to generate a sustainable model, both socially and economically. Okay, so I think that's the main key. And we can say that kind of goal was achieved, because many of the companies are profitable. Most of the companies are profitable. Those that are not are supported by the others, because all the results are consolidated at the end. So we can see that after all these years, 33,000 jobs were created, and 11,000 of them are for persons with disabilities. Right? Some of the companies have really high percentages of persons with disabilities, as we mentioned. Here, for example, at ILUNION ASP, formerly known as Technosite, we have 60% of our total workforce out of 120 people. Right? So that means a lot. And obviously, you're going to have companies operating in different industries, as mentioned. Not only those that are highly intensive in the workforce, because the activity is pretty manual, but also you're going to have highly qualified workforces, like here in Tech, formerly known as Technosite, the Union SAP. Still takes me, you know, to get used. It's going to take me some time. And you see that most of the people here at the company are highly qualified engineers, programmers, psychologists, economists like myself. And you have all these people with disabilities that do have really high qualifications, PhDs and everything. And you end up realizing that you don't see the disability. Disability is transparent. You just see your colleague, the professional that works next to you. And you don't take into account whether the person may be blind or maybe in a wheelchair or anything. You just see the professional, and you see the professional working in equal terms on what you are doing, right? So why is it important that a company actually undertakes specific measures, or how does a company do to actually have that many people with disabilities working in equal terms and with full, let's say, stability? The company has to provide not only physical accommodations, right? But we can think of in an environment like this, office environment, you may need accommodations in ICT, computers, you may need in assistive technologies, software, screen readers, special mouses, rollerballs, whatever you want to think of. Obviously, the building itself, the access is being ready, has been ramps, you can have signage, everything. But you must also have the not so evident accommodation elements that have to do more with the work-life balance. In any company, whether they have a lot of people with disabilities, you're going to need these kind of measures, these kind of work-life balance measures that make life easier for employees, for the professionals to become much more productive, to actually add much more value to the company, to the clients, of course. And in the case of companies that employ a lot of people with disabilities, you need to focus a bit more specific and a bit more broadly, because the specific needs that people may have at a certain point due to different impairments, different needs, obviously have to be addressed. So that has to do with what human resources does. Okay, and you may think of measures like implementing telework, for example, or implementing some kind of specific lunch downstairs in the canteen, if we have one, you know, to accommodate people that may have some kind of organic needs or requirements, that specific food may be available, made available to them. You may have specific accommodations in terms of being able to spend your holidays in this way or the other, so that means more convenient schedule, weekly schedule for you. So it's a whole lot of measures that are going to make life easier for all employees, not only with disabilities, but specifically, especially with disabilities. And I think that's one of the key questions that companies have to understand and have to address. And obviously that has to do with human resources, has to in this case.
And
in fact, my question goes exactly into that direction. We have debated several times on AXSchat that, you know, when someone finishes a degree in human resources or in any sort of training, accessibility is not part of their programs. So how were you able to make sure that the HR department is able to understand and engage with the needs of this workforce?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, it's absolutely necessary that they get to grips with what this means, with what employing large amounts of people with disability may involve. And obviously put in place all those measures and all those accommodations that make as mentioned, life easier for all people, for all employees, but also to help them be much more productive and to make the workplace a much more inclusive place. I mean, as we know, if we have all the accommodations that we may need in terms of some physical elements, but also making ourselves more comfortable, we know that we're going to be much, much more productive in any kind of work. So yeah, definitely HR has a key role to play in this respect.
Interesting. But are you doing any specific type of training with the HR employees themselves?
Well, all the HR employees that end up working here within the organization. Right now we have a centralized HR department for the whole ILUNION business group. These are the guys that are going to take care of the running or designing, and making sure that all these measures implemented in each company, specific company with their specific needs, and are actually implemented properly or changed if necessary or adapted. So we have a centralized HR team that looks after all these details. Obviously, they need to have a really strong knowledge and not only accessibility in general, because they're not going to get really technical, but they're going to need people to let them know what kind of accommodations this candidate or this other are going to need in terms of screen readers, in terms of any other element that they need.
Ricardo, one thing that my book is finally going to be publishing on December 2nd, and I am going to be a guest on AXSchat, yay, about it. But as you know, one of the countries that I wrote best practices about was Spain, and I'm very impressed what Spain has done. And I understand Spain is a work in progress. And, you know, five steps forward, one step back, it's all of us are doing the same thing. But I am curious about a few things. One of them, as Antonio asked you about training your HR, you know, team, and you talked about internally what you're doing. I also would be curious for you to take that in two other directions. Certainly, you're training yourselves, which is very smart. But I'm curious, do you offer that kind of training to other corporations as well as other countries? And one thing that I think we can learn a lot about the successful part of your model is how a ONCE found, the ONCE created a foundation that then created business lines that, and all these businesses support each other. In my mind, it's like the tribe or the village concept, because your goal is to make everyone be successful and to support each other going forward. So I'm lumping a couple of questions together, but just was wondering if you could talk about that.
Yes, indeed. Well, there's an additional element that plays a sort of a key role in the whole picture, and that is employment is not only create a non-foundation helps to create employment not only directly with some business group, but actually helps other companies to create jobs through a specific division or area called inserta FSC. Let's say a headhunting division with the Young Foundation with some 350 professionals working there that actually gathers information about candidates out there with disabilities, generates a huge database with information about 200,000 candidates, interviews all of them, runs a full assessment of what their training levels are, their aspirations are, so forth. And then, on the other hand, works with the companies identifying what their staffing needs are in terms of people with disabilities. We may talk about the quotas later on, and identifying specific positions that may be covered by persons with disabilities, right? Some or several candidates that they have in the data. And so they do this dual assessment, okay? And they put together both sides, they do this matchup, and then that's where the job of FSC inserta ends, right? When these two parts go to the interview, and if they end up signing a contract, great. And the Young Foundation, this Young Foundation division called the SC Insert, does this on the basis of the funds it receives, partly from ONCE and partly from the European Union. So the European Union gives funds to the Spanish government, and the Spanish government in turn gives them to the ONCE Foundation to run this kind of activity that has a name. It's called the Operational Program for the Fight Against Discrimination in the Specific Area of Employment for Persons with Disabilities. Right, so it's mainly a European program that is commissioned to the expert organization in this field, employment, workplace employment for persons with disabilities, in this case on the foundation here in Spain. Of course, there's other organizations that get this kind of task assigned in working in other areas like immigration and extreme poverty and so forth. The foundation was given this assignment by the Spanish government and given these funds from the European Union in order to run this project. And the outcome of this project, this program so far, has been more than 110,000 jobs created in 25 years, more than 50,000 training activities carried out. So the figures are really, really huge, right? So if you ask me, does the ONCE Foundation provide companies with training on how to actually do this? They do provide this kind of services as well, yeah. And they provide this kind of direct, let's say, advice on what kind of candidates they may recruit, but also analyzing what kind of what are the specific positions that can be identified within a company, and also how to implement also these measures, okay, that we were talking about earlier in the interview, okay, the work-life balance. And apart from that, yeah, they do provide some seminars on how to actually implement all these activities from HR departments. So it's something pretty unusual because this division is in itself is recognized as an employment agency. Okay, it would work. It works as any other employment agency here in Spain, but it actually focuses specifically on disabilities. And that's why it's achieved these figures in throughout the years. I don't know whether this answers your question.
It does. It does. Thank you.
I have a question that you know, it's changing a little bit the topic where we have been going so far is, you know, Spain is known for being a country where, you know, famous for tourism. So we have a lot of people going to Spain to enjoy, to go to the beach, to go to different, to visit historic cities. So what can you tell us about, you know, this, how accessible is and how friendly is Spain for people who need some talk for accessible tourism?
Okay, this is, as Deborah said earlier in the interview, we're working in progress here in Spain, of course, and there's still a lot to be done. However, great improvements have been achieved.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you know, I see that, you know, I was looking to the Twitter feed of ONCE, and there's quite a good number of, you know, awards and prizes being given in relation to some to part to that area. So
yes, absolutely. That's one of the as tourism is the key industry in Spain. ONCE Foundation could not. Not to forget this, right? And obviously, it works very intensely, has been working very intensely on this field for many, many years. And that's why it works together with other organizations in Europe to generate good practices, to generate guides, and so forth. ONCE Foundation is not the only organization that works in accessible tourism. I can say fortunately, because that means this means that this is becoming generalized. Okay, and a lot of materials have been created in terms of gathering, for example, guides about accessible hotels, accessible restaurants, with all the information about all the accommodations they have and everything. A few years ago, well, last year it was updated, ONCE Foundation created a guide of accessible beaches. So there's a whole lot of beaches, and there's a search engine there in one of the foundation portals where you can actually find specific beaches, how to get there, what kinds of accommodations are available per province, per town, everything, absolutely everything. And also some of the companies work specifically in this field, like for example Technosite, formerly known as Technosite and Via Libre, have been working in accessible tourism for many years, especially Via Libre, which is now integrated into Union SAP as well, that's a physical accessibility side. They've been working on this for more than 20 years now, helping hotels to become accessible, holiday resorts, towns making improvements in beaches, promenades, obviously all that has to do with urban accessibility, of course. All that has to do with helping, as mentioned, hotels and resorts. Actually, one of the ILUNION companies, this is called ILUNION Hotels, a hotel chain, 13 hotels, a few more, I think. All of them are accessible. Some of them are urban hotels, some other are purely holiday hotels based on located on the coast. And all of them have been certified in universal accessibility. So this means that there's a really, really strong focus on making all these infrastructures and all these facilities accessible, of course. And obviously, ILUNION can be less in this respect, making its terminal hotels accessible. And apart from that, there's interesting examples, just to finish off with this. For example, Barcelona is one of the most accessible, recognized as one of the most accessible cities in Europe, at least, and that's due to the commitment and how the City Council has engaged. Monte Foundation has been working very closely with them, with the transportation company there as well in Barcelona. But there's, let's say, other examples that pose bigger challenges, smaller towns, but bigger challenges. Like, for example, Avila, that's 100 kilometers northwest of Madrid. It's a medieval town with a medieval wall from the 8th century, more or less. And how do you make that kind of town, how do you make it accessible? Well, that was a big challenge that actually won a European award for being one of the most accessible historic city in Europe in 2012. And this was a huge project that we actually did together with the Avila City Council. We're really proud of the outcome. It's an example of making a very, very ancient place with a lot of heritage, and we made it accessible. So we're really, really proud of that kind of accomplishment. So you see that you have like different sides, different facets of this whole industry that is tourism. You have tourism, on which we've been working for a long time, working with Renfe, with the railway operator, providing a service that's called Atento systems to. To reduce mobility travelers, okay, we created that service, and different union companies actually providing the service. So even though it was created by the elite, right? And we also focus on tourism, and we focus on hotels. We also focus on restaurants. We focus on facilities, beaches, natural parks as well. So we tried to cover the whole spectrum, but obviously this is a huge task. But we are really proud with the achievement so far. But still, there's a long way to go.
Yeah, we know that you are also present in Latin America. How are you translating the experience that you have in Spain into the South American countries, and how do you adjust to the different challenges that you obviously are facing out there?
Well, Latin America, we find that the main challenge is legislation. The lack or the legal framework not always existent, and where it's existent, it's not developed. You don't have a legal framework that is fully developed, fully implemented. Where there is, it's insufficiently implemented, and you don't have enough legal instruments so as to actually enforce that legal framework. But they take, many countries are taking steps now, fortunately, because they see that reducing the social gap is an absolutely necessary step for the club. And obviously, disability is a base of a key role in that social gap. And all governments want to work in that field. However, the second biggest challenge is the lack of technical knowledge, hands-on knowledge, on how to actually implement regulations or implement changes, accessibility elements in urban areas in the urban realm and buildings, technology, of course. And the third, I don't know whether third or maybe second, challenge would be the lack of awareness. There's a huge lack of awareness that's also present in many other countries, not only in Latin America, but here in Europe at many, many levels, of course, and the US as well. People still, many people, government levels, very often don't realize that that all citizens should be able to use the public services, public accommodations in equal terms. So we see that people with disabilities are still considered to a large extent second class citizens, unfortunately. And you don't realize that this group are as valid as any other, of course, and can be also taxpayers and participate in society as people participate. And this lack of awareness, as mentioned, is not only at government levels, but also at corporate levels and social levels in general, and families themselves. Okay? So it's a whole sociological, socio-demographic picture that has to be taken into account with different elements in order to be able to address all of the barriers that are still present there. How are we doing? How are we addressing this? Well, we've been doing a huge task in raising awareness in the first place, of course, in working very closely with some governments, in actually providing technical assistance in terms of ICT accessibility and physical accessibility as well, and actually implementing projects that physical changes have been made, conceived. And obviously there's an element of dissemination of this that is absolutely necessary, so we can get other people to see that this is possible, this is real, this has been done somewhere else, and I also want that, so we get that kind of effect. But obviously there's still way to go, and we really are into helping as much as we can, of course, providing expertise so that the community, the local community, may appropriate it, as they say, they acquire it, okay, and may scale. And the only way of doing that is through raising awareness, through training, and through getting governments to enforce legislation, legal framework, obviously, and develop legal frameworks.
Well, Ricardo, we could talk to you all day. It's amazing what you're accomplishing, and as you admit, it's a work in progress, and it's a work that the efforts that are being taken to help other countries, I know that the United States can learn a lot from what's being accomplished in Spain. So I'm looking forward, you know, to continuing to spread the word. But so we have run out of time. So we want to thank you very much for letting us talk to you about all the things that you are accomplishing in Spain. I mean, it's really a best practice, the country. So it's very exciting to see what you are doing. And we look forward to watching what else you will accomplish in the future. So thank you for interviewing with us today, and we will we look forward to learning more about what you're doing in Spain and in other countries tomorrow on AXSchat. Thank you.
Thank you, Ricardo.
Right, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure and an honor for me, of course. Thank you so much for having me on, and I'm looking forward to tomorrow's AXSchat, and looking forward to bringing all these good practices to other countries. So yeah, looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. As a final note, no, we apologize for some of the delays that our listeners and viewers may experience. But this is, we are basically crossing the Atlantic from Ireland to United, from Virginia, and to Spain. So it's something that we need to live with. Thank you so much.